Okay, since Ray Beebe's not here, we're going to do the psalm. It's Psalm 29. Ascribe to the Lord your heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due to his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks in pieces the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon leap like a calf, Sirion like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord strikes with flashes of lightning. The voice of the Lord shakes the desert. The Lord shakes the desert of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord twists the mighty oaks and strips the forest bare, and all in his temple cry glory. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord is enthroned as king forever. The Lord gives strength to his people. The Lord blesses his people with peace. Here ends the psalm. Thank you. That's kind of neat. 10 years ago, if you would have told somebody you could pull up Psalm 29 on your phone, you would have said, what? Isn't
that cool? Free app.
That's a free app, yeah. So good morning, everybody. It's good to see everybody here. We're just glad that you're here at the gathering on this first Sunday in January. Isn't that amazing? Looks like it's going to be a little bit warmer today, praise the Lord, but they're getting hit on the East Coast, but we don't feel sorry for them. Oh, they're complaining about -7 today. Well, we've had it for how long? Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, well, you know. Anyway, it's good to see all of you here, and we're glad that Deborah was able to pull things together. We're going to have hopefully some music.
Thank you.
And we'll see how it works, and just bear with us as we work through the kinks. And are there any announcements besides we got Bible studies, we got a midweek gathering this Wednesday. That's about it. We've got the youth gathering together. Yes, we got things coming up. Got the Ash Wednesday and the Lenten. Yep, no problem. Thank you.
I'm running because I'm hanging out in the back of the row.
Yes, she's in the back row.
Because I'm hanging out with cool kids.
Yeah.
But you're not there. Ash Wednesday is Valentine's Day.
Oh,
so yeah, it's coming fast. So I just ordered a Bible study to look at, so we will be doing Bible study. We're not going to, it's a Lenten soup supper thing, but we're not doing soup. We're just going to either meet at 6:30 to 8 or 7 to 8:30, maybe 6:30 to 8, but we're not going to do supper. It's just getting to be too much of a thing, and Lent is a really long time. So we're not going to have soup, we're just going to do Bible study and be done. May 5th. It's going to be the women's retreat, and we're going to do it overnight again. So open your calendars up and make sure you have that time. We're going to spend the night, and I can't remember what it's called. So anyway, you'll know when I figured it out. Okay, bye.
Hanging out on cool kids so much.
I am.
Morning.
Good morning.
I got to go back to my
the family. Annual savings. I'm going to try to get out this week, so you should have those by the next week for sure. Also, this year, what I'm going to do is put together a income expense statement. So if anybody in the congregation is interested, I just don't want to hand them out, but if you are interested, I'll have it next week so you can look at how much we took in and what we're spending on. It's just going to be a generalization of like five categories. It won't be itemized because I don't think we need to get that much detail, but I want to be as transparent as possible to the congregation where the money's going. So and the other thing is Linda Morrison is going to take over as a treasurer.
This is not going to be.
Oh, what?
I believe in term limits, so.
Gonna get a hallelujah.
I don't think that it's just a better transition and get more people involved and things like that. It's nothing to do with anything it's doing to me or anything I can't do, but just to get more people involved and give other people opportunity to serve. So that'll be happening as well. So thanks.
Okay, why don't you go ahead and start? We're going to work the music here. Thanks.
Please rise. Let us begin in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The Spirit of God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and God saw that it was good. At the beginning of his ministry, Jesus was baptized by John. The heavens opened and the Spirit descended like a dove. Then God said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased."
Thanks be to God.
Please remain standing for the opening song.
Just keep going.
Technical difficulty.
God of heaven and earth, we gather in the name of Jesus to hear your holy word and to be immersed in your Spirit. Speak to us with grace and truth and pour out your love upon us so that this temple may resound with joyful shouts of glory through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A prophet appeared in the wilderness, calling the people to repent, be baptized, and prepare the way of the Lord. We return to the water to confess our sins, giving thanks for the grace of Jesus Christ, the one who has come to save us. God of all glory, you look from heaven and see us as we are, not worthy to kneel at your feet, not ready to welcome your way. Forgive us, gracious God. In Christ, stoop down to save us. Loosen the ties that bind us to sin and set us free to love and serve you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hear the good news of the gospel. As a voice from heaven said to Jesus, so God says to each of us, "You are my beloved child, and with you I am well pleased. In Jesus Christ we are forgiven." Thanks be to God. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share the peace with one another.
Pretty good. First reading is from Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Second reading is from Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 11. What then are we to say? Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in the newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self is crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin, once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you must also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Here ends the readings. Please stand for the gospel.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel according to Mark, chapter 1. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved, and with you I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be seated. And bring the kids up.
Grab a story.
Yeah, grab a story time. Good to see you. So how's everybody doing? We're all cold, aren't we? Now it's going to get warmer, so we can thank God for that. Well, today in my gospel that I just read, we're talking about Jesus getting baptized in the River Jordan. And the River Jordan is not here in the United States. It's way, way far away in another country, because that's where Jesus lived, way, way far away in another country.
Jesus came to my school.
Jesus came to your school? Oh, boy, that must have been nice. Next time he's there, let me know. But maybe he came during Christmas time when they celebrated the birth of Jesus. And now we're celebrating his baptism. So we got the birth of Jesus, and now he's being baptized. And just like you guys, you were born, and I think I baptized all of you, isn't that right? So baptism is what we do because Jesus got baptized. And baptism is a way that God says to each and every one of us, "I love you, I love you, I love you," more than anything else in this world. That's what baptism does. It's where God says to each one of us how much he loves us. And that's what God said to Jesus when he was baptized. "I love you, I love you, I love you." But then he also said, "Well, Jesus, since I love you so much, I want you to go out and spread the good news about me being in this world. And the same thing with you. When God says, I love you, I love you, I love you, he also wants you to go out and spread the good news." Can you say good news?
Good news.
That's good stuff. It's not bad stuff. It's good stuff. So we're supposed to be good stuff people. All right? Okay. Thank you so much. I think somebody's getting antsy here. Yeah. Okay. Grandpa doesn't interest her that much. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it. Well, I don't know how many of you saw this article that was in the Tribune a few weeks ago. It was called Best Bros Discover Their Brothers. Did you hear that story about two men in Hawaii that found out that they were actually brothers, huh?
It was on Facebook. I didn't
read it. Oh, okay. They've been best friends since the sixth grade, a relationship that for many would feel like family. And it turns out that they are. Alan Robinson and Walter McFarlane, both from Hawaii, recently discovered they were brothers after knowing each other for more than 60 years. Can you imagine that? The two learned that they had the same biological mother after doing DNA tests independently. They had no idea. Robinson and McFarlane of Hawaii told their story secretly to a local television station after hosting a party earlier to tell their families. And then, of course, the news got out. The men met as adolescents decades ago and went on to play football together at the same high school that President Obama was from. Even though the two had similar interests, and even though they looked alike, according to some people who knew them, they said they never considered the possibility that they were related to be something that they should be concerned about. But through DNA testing, McFarlane and Robinson found out that they have identical X chromosomes, which means that they shared the same biological mother. Can you imagine that? "Yeah, it was a shock," they said. "It was an overwhelming experience. It's still overwhelming. And we don't know how long it's going to take for us to get over this feeling." But the both retired men are planning to travel together, and they both said this is the best Christmas present they could have ever imagined having, the fact that they found out they were biological brothers. So when I read articles like this, it just makes me kind of amazed at what creation is all about. God's creative activity is just amazing, and the more we find out about his creation, the more we're just thrown back in our chairs and go, oh my gosh, isn't that amazing? How many times have you said that when it comes to things about God's creative activity, and you go, oh, isn't that amazing? And that's what they found out, God's amazing creative activity. And so when we read the book of Genesis, you know, especially that first chapter about God's creative activity, you're talking about the omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent, eternal God of the universe creating this world out of nothing. And on this world, he put a bunch of living creatures with everything they need to be sustained, but he also created one of those living creatures in a very unique manner. This living creature, unlike all the other living creatures, had the capacity to choose. They had a free will. They weren't just strictly guided by their instincts. And then God said, well, you know what? I'm going to give them a reasoning capacity to hopefully guide their free will in the proper direction. Well, it didn't take long for God to realize that these unique creatures were not necessarily going to use their reasoning capacities in the way that he thought they would. And he suddenly realized that these creatures often used their reasoning capacities in a way to go in the opposite direction that he was hoping they would, to do destructive, negative, non-beneficial things. And so he was left with a dilemma. What can I do to correct this situation? I can't take away their free will because they can't be what I designed them to be. Well, maybe if I give them a bunch of rules and regulations that they can follow, maybe that will guide their reasoning capacity so that they make productive, positive, beneficial decisions, not only for themselves, but for others as well. Well, we all know that didn't work. That's the whole Old Testament. It just didn't work. So God had to go back to the drawing board and said, what am I going to do? So he took all his creative activity, the same amount of creative activity that it took to shape and make this world, to shape and make the universe, and he poured it all into one little baby born in Bethlehem called Jesus. All of God's creative activity was poured into one little baby born in Bethlehem called Jesus. And I find that fascinating. God made flesh, the incarnate God. And God said, this Jesus is going to introduce for me another of my wondrous creations, a whole new way of living, a whole new way of existing, a whole new way of doing things for these human beings, and I'm going to call it my godly presence in this world, the kingdom of God. And that's what Jesus ended up doing. His baptism that we celebrate today is the Trinitarian confirmation. It's one of the few times that you find the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit all together at the same time, confirming the fact that Jesus said, yes, I will introduce this new way of doing things, this new radical existence, this new way for people to have a positive, constructive means of making decisions. Because that's what this new kingdom includes. It literally transforms people's minds and the reasoning capacities so that they start making more constructive, beneficial, and positive decisions, not only for themselves, but for the whole world as well, especially people close to them. It was a whole new way of doing things. And Jesus in his baptism said, you know what? I'm going to take that burden upon myself to introduce this radical new creation called the kingdom of God that had never existed on the face of this earth before, that finally gave people a choice between all the negative stuff and something far more positive and beneficial. They will now have a choice. So Jesus did his thing through his teaching and his preaching, through his ministering and his miracles, through his whole life, his ugly death on the cross, and his marvelous, beautiful resurrection. Jesus gave us the gift, and through him, God's creative activity was able to establish this brand new existence that people could tap into if they chose to do so. And that's the big thing, because God didn't want to eradicate free will. He wanted people to freely choose to take this new existence into their very lives. And once they did, their whole reasoning capacity changed. It was almost as though God was working DNA miracles in their brain. And history has proven to say yes to that. Over and over again, through millions of people who have made that leap of faith and said, yes, I want this in my life. I don't want to be controlled by my own urges and my own reasoning capacities. I want this new way of doing things in my life. It takes a leap of faith. And as Paul says in our lesson for today, it means that that old stuff must die, which just caters to this world, and unfortunately caters to the evil one as well. That must slowly die so that this new stuff can be uploaded into one's life, called a new nature. Paul talks about that in our lesson, and it makes all the difference in the world. It doesn't mean that all things are going to be hunky-dory. Oh, you know, it just means now you have the Holy Spirit. You have this new reasoning capacity that you didn't have before to help you make decisions that are not only beneficial and positive for just me, myself, and I, but for others as well, including God himself, to further his cause in this world. That's your choice. It just takes one aha moment. Isn't that right, Victoria? One aha moment where for some reason you say, Lord, I want this in my life. That has to happen. It's not going to happen because you're a Lutheran. It's not going to happen because you're coming to the gathering. It doesn't happen because you're a good person. You have to be the one that says, at one time in your life, I want this kingdom to be part of my life and for the Lord to be part of my life. And I want to be a beneficial, constructive person for God's kingdom. This new, radical, creative existence that Jesus introduced 2,000 years ago. Isn't that fascinating? How lucky we are. And folks, we live in a country where you can do this openly and freely without somebody pointing a gun at your head or throwing you into jail. There should be no excuse, except maybe your own unwillingness to take that leap of faith. And that's up to you. I've shared with you, I took that leap of faith in college. Okay? That old, good old student union. It can happen anywhere. It doesn't have to be a campus crusade thing. It could be you sitting in your room at home making that decision. That's all it takes. And what I find fascinating is that I believe that God literally, when you make that choice, recreates your DNA emotionally, your DNA emotionally, your DNA psychologically, your DNA mentally, your DNA socially, your DNA in all aspects of your existence, including your physical. What do you say? Well, yeah, I'll get to that in just a minute. What's amazing is that once you take that leap of faith and make God's kingdom one of your priorities in life, hopefully the priority, you suddenly have what you call brothers and sisters in Christ, not just fellow Lutherans, but literally brothers and sisters in Christ who are fighting the same battle every day that you are for a worthy cause. In everything they say and do, not just coming to church, but taking this cause seriously. Isn't that right? And they all understand the nature of what you're going through. They're literally brothers and sisters in Christ who are now bound together emotionally, psychologically, mentally, spiritually, socially, and of course, physically. I'll get to that in just a minute.
You say physically? Oh my God.
Well, just like these two brothers who were bound together for 60 years, emotionally, psychologically, mentally, spiritually, socially, they just found out that they're bound together physically. Isn't that amazing? It's like icing on the cake, you know? And we are too. You may have never heard of this amazing molecule, laminin. Have you heard of laminin? Well, laminin is an amazing molecule. It is a protein found in the extracellular matrix. You probably know what this is all about. The sheets of protein that form the substrate of all internal organs, also called the basement membranes. Laminin is the major non-collagenous component of the basal lamina. It has four arms that combine to four other molecules. The three shorter arms, which are horizontal, are particularly good at binding to other laminin molecules, which is what makes it so great at forming sheets of tissue. The long arm, which is vertical, is capable of binding to cells, which helps anchor the actual organs to the membrane. So structurally, the laminin protein has lots of flexibility in connecting with various molecules. And that's why it is an integral part of the structural scaffolding in almost every animal tissue. Now, it is amazing what the function of this little molecule is, because laminin is responsible for holding all of our body structures together. Basically, it is the rebar of our bodies. But what is most amazing is actually what laminin looks like under the microscope. Laminin is actually in the shape, what did I say? Of a cross. Isn't that amazing? So the basic structural unit of your body and mine is in the shape of a cross. When I first heard of this, I was just blown away. It literally holds our bodies together, and that is exactly what the cross of Christ does. The power and love of God, who did not withhold his own son, but gave him to be crucified so that we could have this brand new creation of a kingdom. So Jesus is that mediator. He's the way, the truth, and the life. And that laminin is that new kind of physical DNA that binds us together as we work together to further this kingdom. Isn't that amazing? We have all this DNA good stuff that's changed our existence. So ask yourself, what do you think? The very molecule that holds our bodies together is in the shape of the cross, which is the very act and deed that truly holds us together in this furthering of God's kingdom. Please rise. Lord, we just thank you again for your marvelous creative activity that never ceases to amaze us, not only in this physical world, but also in the spiritual world as well. We need to take that leap of faith and let your laminin work in all of us, you might say, that cross-bearing activity in all aspects of our existence. And take that leap of faith and say, yes, I want to be bound together with Christ and my fellow brothers and sisters for a worthy cause. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
I believe in God who creates and recreates all that exists and everything I need. I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, who was born and was faithful. Jesus lived a life of example and teaching, and sacrificed his own life so the promise of the resurrection could belong to me. I believe the Holy Spirit is the presence of God with me. God's Spirit calls me into relationship, builds the Church of Christ, and releases God's forgiving power within me. I believe I can experience the love of God through the Word, the sacraments, prayer, and the loving community of believers. Amen.
The earth belongs to God, our Creator. Every good thing is a gift from the Lord. Let us glorify God through the gifts of our lives.
Amen.
Please be seated for the offering.
Yeah, the one that you had up there baptized.
Speakers, and then that will just be for the microphone, because I don't know what happened.
Okay, let's bow our heads in prayer at this time. Thank you. So please pray openly or freely or silently to yourself for prayers of joy or prayers of concern. Thank you.
Father God, I just ask you to be with Stephanie Ramazuski as her surgery is coming up on the 10th. Be with her and heal her, Father God, and give Greg the patience to help heal her.
Lord, keep your healing hands, please, on our ray.
Oh, please rise. Sorry.
And thank you for the joys that you brought to our life.
Dear Heavenly Father, I ask that you be with my dear friend, Audrey, who was just diagnosed with lymph node and lung cancer, dear Lord. She just went in the hospital on Saturday. Just be with the family and with her. They're really scared, and there's not really good news in that. Just put your loving arms around her and her children and all of those that love her. Give them strength. And know that you are with her, and that this is not a punishment, and that we should thank you in our times of trials and tribulations.
I'd like to lift up our dear friend Mary Jo Light, who is beginning her cancer treatments also. Thank you, Father.
Father, we also ask you to be with the DeClercq family as they're going through a loved one's passing. We also ask you to be with Dick as he passed last Sunday, as we were praying for him. Father, be with him and his family.
Lord, we just give you thanks for waking up each day in a good old USA, and also being members of your kingdom. Two wonderful gifts. Help us to utilize it to further your cause, not our own, but yours.
Heavenly Father, continue prayer for Marilyn and Jack Bryden.
Lord, be with Barb Gibson with her upcoming surgery. Be with my mother-in-law, who's having some health issues, but she's on a healing path. And all these things we lift up to you in your most precious name, and let's all say, amen.
Amen.
Now, on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and he gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And again after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated and come forward at the usher's direction, please. Thank you. Please rise. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep in his grace, truth, and love. Amen.
Amen.
We were baptized in Christ Jesus. We were baptized in his death. Was raised victorious, we might live a brand new life. And if we have been united in a dreadful death like his, we will all be reunited. Water and the witness in the breaking of the bread, in the waiting arms of Jesus, who is risen from the dead. God has made a new beginning from the ashes of our past, in the losing and the winning we hold fast. Glory be to God the Father, glory be to Christ the Son, glory to the Holy Spirit, ever three and ever one. As it was in the beginning, glory now resounds again in a song that has no ending.
Go forth in the light and love of God, giving glory to God in all that you do.
Amen.
Beloved children of God, Spirit, Son, and Father, all the blessings of heaven are yours. Alleluia.
Amen.
Now go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We keep in mind there's still Bible study tonight at the Phoebe's, is that right? And also, thanks to Deborah for doing a valiant job.
Yay, Deborah.
We'll be back next week.